Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for joining today's webinar with our very special guest, Sarah Silver, and also Topher Scott as well. I shall introduce you to those guys in the very near future. If this is your first Phase One webinar, just so you know who you're listening to right now, my name is David. I'm part of the software marketing team based out of Copenhagen in Denmark. The session that we have today is going to run for around 60 minutes, and the whole purpose of our webinars is that they're nice and interactive as well, so that you can ask questions throughout. The way you do that, if you're on your Mac or PC, if you look at the bottom of your GoToWebinar control panel, you'll see a section at the bottom called Questions. Just type in a question and that will come straight through to us. If you're watching on your iOS device or on your Android device, you'll see a question mark icon at the bottom of the interface on the app. And again, tap that question mark and that will come straight through to us as well. Otherwise, you just need to sit back and enjoy the two guests that we have with us today. So you know who you're going to be listening to, we have Sarah Silver. She's currently sitting in her studio in New York. And with her is a colleague, Topher Scott, who's also a photographer in his own right, but also works extensively with Sarah on set as well. I was lucky enough to work with them recently to produce a video of Sarah working behind the scenes, and I certainly learnt a lot from both of them, and I know you will do as well. So hopefully Sarah and Topher are there lurking in the background somewhere. Are you there, guys? Hello.
We are.
You hello. Are great.
Hi.
Just making me nervous for a second there.
You're here. No, we're not leaving you. We're not leaving you, I promise.
Good. So basically, I'm going to hand you over to Sarah and Topher so we can learn a little bit more about them and of course, learn a great deal about their workflow as well. So if you just bear with me one second, I'm going to pass presentation rights over to those guys, which will just take 1 second. So, Sarah and Topher, you should have a pop-up on screen now.
Yep, show my screen.
Perfect.
Can you see us?
In a second, yes, we can.
All right. Well, we're starting with my personal favorite shot recently of me shooting on the ground. I usually find myself on the floor, yeah, Topher?
Usually on the floor, rolling all over. By the end of the day, it's like Sarah is a lint tray.
I have holes in every pair of jeans. Every knee is ripped. My mother would not be pleased. But I do it for the work, right?
Absolutely.
Seriously.
Anything for the work.
Hello, everybody. I hope we are all ready to get some Cap 1 awesomeness going on. And basically, Topher and I sat down and thought long and hard about what we wanted to tell you guys. We really love Cap One. We really love photography, and we find that the combination together is kind of magical, yeah?
Absolutely. Sarah and I work together all the time. We love Capture One so much. We love everything that it can do. And the great thing is that when I work with Sarah, I get to exercise so many amazing shortcuts and efficiencies that only Capture One offers us.
We're a little nerdy, so bear with us if we go too fast on any one point, because we're kind of like nerdy tech freaks.
Yes, absolutely.
Another thing is that we coordinated this with a three-part idea that it's really about setup, shoot, and post, or otherwise known as export. And so that's how we're going to structure this conversation. You ready to dive right in, Toph?
Totally ready to dive
in. All right. And by the way, if you have questions, please ask. We love... You know, I'm not going to say stump us because that's not fair, but we're totally willing to answer anything we possibly can, all right?
Anything in the realm of Capture One 8.
Yes, nothing else. Okay, well, how about this? Do you want to talk about what our favorite tools are? I think that's important.
Let's do
right?
it. Let's dive
that's
into
part of
favorite
setup.
Tools.
All right.
Okay.
All right, so, well, let's show them. And that is right there. Topher, let's talk about a favorites tab.
Okay, favorites tab. Working efficiently is so huge. So, coolest thing, if you control click see where my mouse is here. If you control click here, you can add a lovely tool tab. You can add something called a quick tool tab. Quick tool tab can be customized with anything you want, really. You can
show them our favorites.
Start removing everything. Let's clear these guys out, and I'm just showing you how to remove whatever you like.
Because we're picky. We want to see only the things that we want to see. I don't want a whole bunch of clutter. And, you know, customizing is, I think, the best way to be more efficient, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, adding a new tool. Let's control click into here and add a tool. First of all, first and foremost, we have to have our exposure tool just as a
completely
basis to work. We work with, you know, we're making lighting adjustments all day long. It's easy for us to gauge things, make quick adjustments, and base our lighting adjustments off of tenths of stops, which we see in this tab here.
We get a little bit specific, yeah?
maybe too specific.
Maybe too specific.
I'll skip over some of
that. All right, that's
okay. And we're not going to go into any particular order right now, but we're just going to throw in all of our favorite tools. How about that?
Do it.
Okay. So we love clarity. We love the color balance. No, we love color editor.
I'm obsessed with the color editor. We'll explain why later.
We're going to collapse that for now. We're actually going to collapse all of these. We're going to add in a curve. Love
must
curves.
Must live with a curve.
Next, levels. Have to have levels as well.
Yes.
We also love, what else do we love? We love, let's go into next capture naming. That's
yeah,
a good one.
That's important because otherwise Topher has to scramble to get that next name.
Absolutely. And then we also love, we have to have a white balance tool.
And styles and presets.
And styles and presets.
Because for me, everything we do is building off of another shoot. I use styles and presets. Basically, the exposure, clarity, color editor, curve levels, and white balance can be saved, and then we'll use them in a style and preset. And starting from an old shoot and building into a new shoot is very helpful. Now, I'm going to go and pull up a shot. Shall I? Let's pull up a shot. Let's take out the, it's filtering right now. Can you turn off the filter?
Yes. Let's turn this off here. Okay.
All right. So let's talk about this for a second. I'm going to do something called clone variant. I don't want to talk about clone variant because it's not really a new feature, but I'm using it here just to show a little bit about what we've done to the picture. All right. Now, in order to really talk about these favorites tabs, which is also interesting because we really want to talk about how we kind of work in color. Color is really important, right, Toph?
Color is absolutely huge.
So I'm going to zero out.
Wait, one sec.
Yes.
Let's turn this guy off.
Oh, yeah, let's turn that guy off. We're gonna zero out what we've done to this picture.
So as you can see, what we just did, just quick, we've turned this off so that we're not applying this effect to both versions of this photo.
God forbid.
We're going to hit a Command R to reset back to the original flattened out raw settings.
Whoa. All right. Well, Topher, God, I love color.
Yes.
So let's talk about what we did a little bit by using the Favorites tab.
Okay. So we're going to click on to this one. This photo on the right has our adjustments. This is before, which is zeroed out, no settings. So let's open up. Well, let's come back to color editor, because that's not really applicable to this one. But we can see these things, which are.
So the first thing I would do is apply the gray balance. Can we do that?
Absolutely.
Okay. So we've already used a gray card, but I don't want to have to go back into picking a neutral.
So
let's just get the white balance right.
You can see that the white balance on our adjusted photo is at 5611 Kelvin versus 5379 Kelvin. So we're going to copy just that balance and then apply it here.
Well, that's still a big difference, Topher.
Huge difference.
All right, well, let's talk about what we did to make the color so awesome on the right.
Well, another big thing that's happening here is when we look at our exposure tab, we've done quite a bit of desaturation as well. 20 points, actually.
Yeah, and I would say that off the bat, my go-to is the DSAT. I don't think you can ever go wrong to DSAT until they start to look dead, right?
Exactly.
So keep DSATing until it's like the point of no return. It's like beautiful, 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 dead. Okay, then bring it back again.
So we're going to copy that now, and we're going to apply that here. That's looking better already.
That's a huge difference. You want to toggle back and forth? Undo.
That's before and with.
Wow, that's really, I like that. And nobody's dead yet, right?
Right.
Everybody still has, she still has a nice skin tone to her. Well, what else did we do?
Let's take a look, shall we? Okay, so another big thing that's happening is we've got a curve. This curve is playing a significant role in how our highlights read and also how our shadows read.
And I think pretty much off the bat, and I will say this as a general rule, I have never done a shoot that didn't have an S-curve. Never, ever. It's one of those default things I automatically apply. An S-curve really brings, it makes your blacks pop, makes your whites pop. It gives...
It's going to make your photos sing.
Yeah.
It just gives it some tonal...
Tonal definition,
exactly.
Right? And so S-curve, S-curve. Just say the word S-curve over and over again. Let's do it.
Okay, so we're going to apply that now. Boom.
It's not a very steep curve either. When
no.
You look at this.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I haven't done... I mean, here.
It's not deep shadows.
Here's a steep curve.
Not, exactly.
This is pixel death. That doesn't look very attractive.
That's rough.
No, that's rough. So be... conscious that you don't
the
go
thing is
forward,
you don't want to kill your high you don't want to kill your detail with the curve. You want to enhance it but not kill it.
Yeah, exactly. And I think you'll know when you break it, right? It's bend it, bend it, bend it, oops, too far, which is pretty much the rule for everything we do.
Absolutely.
Okay, wait, now this is one of my favorite things. It's sort of this level shift that brings that final finesse, and I think we do it really in this order, which is another reason why we've got these favorites tabs set up like this. I will do the curve first, and then the level for me is more of like a, it's adding salt and pepper.
This is a nice mixology, a very specific mixology tool for color. This allows you to really tweak in various zones, in your shadows, your midtones, and your highlights, in each channel, and really come up with a perfect secret sauce for your images. After you've made some of your other global settings. So we use it very carefully. And that's also, that's basically the big thing you're not seeing here in our zeroed out image. We have a few effects on it now. But what's happened here is if you look at our RGB overall, we have pulled up our shadows a little bit. We have adjusted our highlights and brought them down a few points to 250. We have some things going on in the red channel.
Ah, separate channels.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, channels. This is a really important part because we go in to each individual channel.
Exactly. So we have some things going on in the red channel, and we have some things going on in the blue channel, just barely in the midtones. But these things have such a huge impact on the color. So we're going to copy that and apply that here. Huge. Look at that shift.
Huge.
We have shifted in those channels so much. So there we go.
Wow.
So before, after.
Unbelievable. You know, I think that there's a tint change too.
There's definitely some things going on with the hair. I think we did that in the advanced color edit though.
Ah. Can we go into color? My favorite.
Okay, so this is Sarah's favorite tool. She loves to use this one
all the time.
This is
my super favorite.
Let's see. We do have a number of advanced color edits, as you can see there.
Which is so obvious for blue changes. There's no blue in this. Well, had there been blue, it would have turned other colors. Actually, they're all zeroed out. Well, one of them. All right, so let's talk about what we did with that sort of peachy tone.
Okay, so the peachy tone is obviously picking up. I mean, this. Let's look at the selected color range. This is another advanced part of this tool. You're able to sort of isolate well.
And because everything is pretty much black and white except for that, you don't really see.
You don't. Yeah.
No.
But we can see that it's definitely what's happening here is that it's affecting the skin tones, and it's also by proxy affecting the hair a touch.
A touch. And you know what? For me, by the time we've made all these beautiful changes, the last thing to go, I really want to take a little bit of that kind of warmth out of the hair and warmth out of the skin and get that I don't know, I guess let's call it like a modern sort of editorial look that really brings, I mean, the movement has to sing because it's got to look cool.
Absolutely, and this definitely freshens it up. It allows you to make these tweaks without going into an unbelievable zone. So, I mean, just as an overview, we're going to play with it here, because to recreate the exact original would be a challenge, but...
I know.
Because we do it on the fly, and so many other variables happen. But you can literally use this tool here to pick something up.
Yeah,
so let's
that warmth
pick this,
of the hair, right?
And then you can...
Desaturate
that here. I mean, we could pull it all the way out. We can rotate, actually, the color a little bit.
Turn her into a smurf.
Yeah, we're going to turn her into something, you know. This isn't exactly a desired effect, but you get
the
point.
I don't think that makes the picture look any better, Topher. Okay, at this point, I think it's really important that there is no right answer to color.
There's your personal preference, taste.
Right?
Exactly.
But the only wrong answer is not to play with it. Because
right. Whatever
you start with in camera can be made so much better once you start to really, I don't know, start to add changes. And not asking the question, that is the only thing you're not supposed to do. You got to try. You can always say no. Now, I wanted to do one thing, Topher. Can you pull in a shot where we changed color drastically, like with one of the point shoes?
Absolutely.
Because this is where the color really comes in. Oh, look, those are gigantic. Yeah.
Okay.
I want to talk a little bit about the color editor because it makes a huge difference.
Here.
Yeah, there. That is not a final, though. Let's do this one. I like that shot better. Okay. So we're in the color editor for a second, as you can all see, and I'm going to just get everything else out of the way. So that's all we're looking at. All right? Now, as you can tell, the color editor has a lot of changes in here. I'm sort of like mousing over this area. So what I wanted to do first, Topher, I want you to zero out the color editor because I want you to show everybody what color the shoes are.
All right, shall we make a variant, a clone variant?
Clone variant.
Okay.
Do it.
So I'm just quickly here, control clicking on this.
And I'm not going to talk about clone variant other than the fact that cloning your variant allows you to make a non-destructive change but not make a permanent change to your original. So I can try umpteen a number of clone variants and not lose my super favorite settings, because that's embarrassing when you can't get back and then you're scrambling.
Like I am right now.
Like you are right now.
To find those that I just yelled.
Here, I just saw them. Da, da, da. Such a nice thing. I lost it. There. Now, two. Where'd number one go? It's so nice to have a partner in crime. I
okay,
will say
10
that.
Seconds. That's
you
what
broke
happened.
It.
That's what happened. Okay.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
So,
here we go.
Okay, so cloning variant, all right? Does anybody have any idea what color those shoes were? Oh, my God, look at that. Well, why are they purple, Topher? That's because all we had was purple paint. So dancer comes in, Sarah Mearns, fantastic New York City Ballet dancer, comes in, and she says, I could only find purple paint in, for painting the shoes. Is that okay? And I said, no problem. In fact, it's better that it was purple because I can isolate just the purple. Do it, Topher.
Absolutely. Okay, so...
And put all the settings on except for color. That way we...
Everything except for...
Everything
but okay.
Except for that color.
Okay, so let's just reset this one thing then.
Wrong shot.
Wait. This one? Oh. Here we go. Wrong one.
Yes. Good. Okay, so now we're just going to reset the color. And
okay.
Do me a favor, let's have both of these up at the same time.
So,
okay. Let's talk about how to pick the color.
Let's make this one like that. Okay, so...
And it's kind of amazing, right? I mean, that purple is completely wrong, and yet it doesn't even factor into my decision at all, because I know that it's going to be gone, and it's going to be gone on set, not in Photoshop. Like, absolutely. I can do it right here as a local adjustment.
That was a huge thing. Being able to see it and preview it live just helped us determine whether or not it worked as a shot too, which is great. So what we did, let's start rotating this. I believe we went more in this direction. Let me pull this one up. There we go. Okay. No. We're just going to have that up for
That's
now.
Okay.
Okay, so...
Well, why don't you start over, though? Explain how you grab that tool at all.
Okay.
You grab the picker.
Okay. Just grabbing the picker. In your color editor tab, and we like to use the advanced tab versus the basic.
It's more
you can
refined.
Definitely refine things and tweak things a little bit, you know, more carefully than you can in the basic color editor. So using this guy right here, we're going to pick up that purple. And as you can see, what you pick up starts to load up in the panel. And
click View Selective Color Range.
Now
you can see it only isolates the purple. It's another way of being able to tell whether or not you picked a good selection or not. If she was also painted purple, you would have picked up all of her skin.
Yeah.
So thank God on this shoot, we didn't paint the model purple.
So now that we have that, and we're just looking at that and only that color, we can start tweaking it.
Make it blue.
So let's push it. Let's see. Okay, there you go. There's blue.
That's pretty
horrible. We've rotated the hue all the way over.
Yep. And I'm going to turn off the selected color range for a second so we can see everything. We're going to have to slide it.
Okay. So back to purple and then all the way over here. And now we have like sort of a lavender color going on here.
Exactly.
We can, the next thing is, you know, playing with the saturation a little bit. I mean, this is going to have a huge impact. Boom.
Electric.
It's like electric.
Make them gray.
And now
nothing.
Completely desatted.
And you're only picking up the shoes.
Exactly.
It's literally like.
And a little bit of the dress.
A green screen for your photo shoot on model, right?
Exactly.
Now, David Grover, I do believe you said you had a great question for us. Do you want to ask?
Yes, correct. Paul was asking, because I know this is something you and I chatted about when I was in your studio. He's asking, how does Capture One behave when using different cameras with different sensors, for example, CCD to CMOS? He has various cameras and would like to standardize. And I know on this shoot you were using the IQ250, but you also have other IQ cameras and SLRs as well. So obviously you need to normalize to some extent.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, here's actually a really fascinating answer for this, is that we use all different chips, all different cameras, and what we've done is created a basic starting point for each camera. We basically put each camera up and matched it with a starting out setting. So on one chip, we pull out a little bit of yellow. On one chip, we add a little bit more contrast, and we actually have... let's see, is it in here? It's in here. So in styles and presets, we actually have, it's what I call my, user styles. If you guys can see this, I have different settings for different types of cameras. It's called the silver default, and different silver defaults have different settings based on the camera. And then the best part is that through these settings, I'm able to get pretty much the same response no matter what camera we're using. Right.
That's
pretty awesome.
That is the goal. We find the different where different things are pulling out in different backs or different camera systems, and then we try to sort of calibrate across the board so that they all match.
Correct. I hope that answered the question, because that was kind of a cool question. Good question. All right. I know that time is limited, so what I want to do is talk a little bit about editing. I want to talk about how we get through things fast, because I know that while you're on set, you're working, you have limited time, and everybody wants an answer immediately. So let's talk about what you do to get around quickly while you're shooting. Well, One of the things that I do is that quick edit with colors because I can see the color fast. If you guys see, I use green. Green pops out really well in the software, and green usually means green means go. Clients know green means go. They like green. And as I shoot, I pull up green tags on every favorite shot, and then when we go back and pick our favorite, I usually give it a 5-star rating because then I know that green, favorite, and 5-star, that's sort of like double favorite. And when I'm going through with a client and I'm trying to figure out what the best shot is, I usually then sort or filter with just the greens. Do you want to, let's pick one that has more selects though. Let's do that. All right, so this team feels like a good one. Pick all the greens.
Okay.
We sort with a filter. That's actually sort of two different things because you can sort, but you can also filter. So this is technically a filter.
And we've activated this filter using a hotkey that we've set up.
But you can also turn it on and off right here. And then, of course, apparently I didn't pick a super favorite on set. And if anybody wants to vote right now, I guess there's no question in my head it really is this one. And you can always sort by the 5-star and the green. But it's nice because I'll be on set and say we'll have a bunch of super faves, which I'm going to just randomly pick a couple. Like, ooh, I like this one. And ooh, I like this one, which is probably a lie, and this one. And, you know, whoa, she does not. That's not a moment. There. Again, sorting all the greens, right? Selecting them. Oopsie. Wrong. I'm hitting the wrong. And then I'll sit there on set and I'll say, hey, guys, these are your top 6 selects. What's your favorite? And we'll go back in and pick the one super fave with a 5-star. And this is, you know, I don't like to over inundate my clients and crew with too many options all at once. So you show them just what they need to see.
Absolutely.
And then we kind of pick from there.
That's the beauty of this. Filters allows you to make live on-set presentations quickly.
Oh my God, and we do it a lot. Like, hey, these are the steps. And, you know, let's move on.
Yeah.
Because it's time saving.
And it saves a ton of time, and it saves even more time if you set this as a hotkey.
Yes. Do you want to talk about smart albums? Really
yes.
Fast.
Smart albums.
Why do we like smart albums?
We love smart albums because they can really, it's part of the whole filtering system. It allows us to isolate our faves out of the thousands of images that we might shoot in a day.
And it is thousands of images. I mean, I got to say, at any given day, how many shots do you think we actually
3,500
recorded?
About.
3,500?
On average.
Okay, on average. Mm-hmm. And that's on an average day. Sometimes I could go
sometimes
a little
way
overboard,
more.
Right? Oh my God. But in order to keep track of all of these different shots, every time we change an outfit, every time we change a look, every time we change a location, we give it a new folder. If we only shot into one master folder, I think I would go crazy. Would you go crazy?
I would definitely go crazy because, I mean, I couldn't imagine processing or working that way. It would be a nightmare to sort it out.
So part of the reason why we like to use smart albums is because you can't see all of your favorites at one time because all of your favorites are in different folders. How do you take care of that problem? Well, smart folders. Would you like to make a smart folder for
us?
I
would love to. So I'm actually just going to get rid of these for now, just so we can start from scratch. How about that? Okay. So as Sarah was saying, as Sarah just demonstrated, she's made some selects throughout the day with her clients. She's made her favorites here. This happens all day long in each folder, different faves. Okay, so we want to put these into one group to see at the end of the day or throughout the day our favorites overall.
I think it also helps to keep track of what you've done. I mean, you need to keep going back and renegotiating what your favorites are, seeing how things are shaping up. You know, the super faves will change. The top selects will change. By the time the day is done, it might change.
It's a whole different,
right?
It could be a whole different thing.
Yeah.
So in this section of the library, you see session albums. We're going to go to this little plus sign here and add a smart album. Now, we would like to create a smart album just for our top favorite green selects that we've made so far. So we're going to go to search criteria. Well, first I labeled it, and then we're going to go to search criteria.
And why do you label it? You got to keep track of the stuff. Do not make things generic. Label it. You won't even know what you chose.
Exactly. And then in search criteria, we're going to select color tag, because that's what we're filtering, right? Something that's based on a color tag. I mean, it can be any criterion, but for now, let's focus on color tag. So what is the color tag? Well, let's delete this accessory one here. Color tag is green. Okay, great. That's all you need in order to create a smart album that's going to filter only greens. The trick is, in order to get your greens, your green select images to appear in that album, the folder, the shoot folder, has to be favorited. So it has to appear in your session
and
favorites.
And Topher, that is the rookie moves that everybody makes. They say, how come my smart folders aren't picking up anything? It has to be in the favorites. But really important, if there is a folder in your favorites that has things you don't want to look at, then you should make sure it's not put in. For instance, what if you don't include trash in your favorites?
Right. If we add that to favorites, that's going into...
It'll feed into
five
your
stars,
greens. Yeah.
Anything in the session albums that picks it up, it will pick it up.
Exactly. So don't have a favorites folder that's some old shoot. It'll also pick up, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And in order to add something to your favorites that is not there, just quickly, you're going to click on the folder in question, control click, and then add to favorites. That will make it appear up here in your session favorites section. So now let's look at our green selects. These are all of the selects Sarah has made throughout the day. And this is an ever-evolving edit depending on what she does. She can even change it from right here.
I'm looking at it. I'm taking stock. Okay, we've got these, and you can look at it and you say, no, I'm not really feeling, I mean, that was not a good one. That's a good one. That was me demonstrating. Let's get rid of that. The minute I untag it green, it automatically knows to pull it out of that smart folder because it no longer has the green tag. Literally, it's not being deleted from the session. It's just being deleted out of that smart album.
Exactly. These are not duplicates of your images.
No.
This is just sorting them into a place, and it's presenting them in another place.
Like, for instance, I killed that shot. Let's get rid of it. And so now I have a much smaller group of images to look at. And it's, being able to look over the entire shoot all at once and say, these are the favorites. I mean,
and this is how she builds a story,
yeah.
Essentially. This is how she gets to the nitty-gritty and finally...
Hate that. Don't like that. I don't know what I was thinking. I still don't know what I was thinking. Not as good. Much better. And being able to look at two pictures together and say, which angle is really the most dynamic? I don't like to cast such a narrow net right at the beginning. And again, editing is really your own personal preference, but I do believe that this is the best way to go.
Do we want to get into yellow selects?
No.
No. Okay.
No. Okay. Let's see. Do you want to talk about compare variant really fast?
Let's talk about compare variant.
I'm not saying that you need to use compare variant. I'm just saying that because we love it so much, we wanted to share it with you how we use it.
Okay.
What is compare variant, Topher? No, seriously. I mean, by the sound of it, what it means to me is a lifesaver. But let's explain it a little bit.
Let's do that. Okay. So the beautiful thing about building, especially with the way Sarah works, is that she's building a story, and it's nice to be able to reference what came. So say we just did shot A, we just did look A. Okay, great, got that one done. Now we're moving on to shot B. It's nice as we get through the day, as we get to shot E, if she's referencing throughout the day what we last did in terms of the previous shot folder. So Let's look at this one. This was our final select from this one. So what I tend to do is we're going to create an imaginary, not that. Why won't that close? we're going to create a new folder just to demonstrate this. So we're going to call this, you know, temporary folder. This was Sarah's favorite shot from that look. We're going to copy it by doing a drag and option into not test. Wrong place.
Or not.
Or not. Okay. Option drag into temp. That's where we're going. All
right. And this is how we would start the next shot.
And now we're going to hit return on this. And what
so
that does.
So easy. Return.
It sets it as a compare. So every other shot.
Or not.
What happened?
There you go.
That's not.
And that was it. How's our weather?
So what happens is now we have this set. As you can see, there's a little outline around the image. We have this set as a compare variant. So basically, as we start shooting in new images, those images are going to go side by side with this. They're going to get compared to this. So let's find a folder that has images in it just for fun. Okay, here we go. So I'm hitting return on this. It is now the compare variant. So
why don't you on...
Okay. Yeah. So now, say we're shooting. Images are coming in. Boom, 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 boom. And what's happening is
Wait, this
every
is really
time...
funny. I forgot about that. Yeah, that's the secret, by the way, to get good movement with hair is to start with it all in front of her. So as we're shooting, new shots are coming up, and we're using our old shot as a reference. And more than anything, we're using this old shot as a reference because what if somebody bumps the camera? What if somebody, we want to make sure that nothing's changed. We can see that the exposure hasn't changed.
We can also see that our style is holding
right.
up.
Yes, exactly. Love that. Now, David Grover, I do believe that you had a question about tethering.
Yeah. Excuse me. Should have cleared my voice first. Paul was asking... Now, I've seen your setup in the studio. Of course, people can't necessarily see that now. But a couple of people were asking about Capture Pilot, which I know you don't use, but you have a pretty excellent tether cart setup, which you can describe, and also the way you use a third monitor for your own purposes as well. Okay. And maybe even, I think you're going to come to it later, but in your process recipes with using a service like Dropbox as well. So maybe we can take that later, but talk a little bit about your tether setup and why you do tether as well.
Any pictures?
I think there is on your behind the scenes, if I remember.
Yes. Well, let's see. I have some behind the scenes pictures here of our setup. Okay. Let's see. I do believe. All right. So here, this is a good example. All right. We have, even better. There you go. Okay, do you guys see this? Topher's on the left. I'm in the middle. That's our beautiful dancer, hairdresser, whole crew. Now, if you see over here, it's my camera locked down on tripod because in this particular case, I do believe we wanted no movement on my part. Sometimes I get a little crazy and I tip the camera in funny directions. So on this shot, I do believe we were locked down. This is our main computer cart. If you can see this, this computer cart is really cool right here on the right. It was custom made for us. It has two monitors in it. Let's see if there's another reasonable shot. Sort of, I don't know, can you guys see there's two monitors? One is in, and the whole thing folds into a neat box. You can stick it on a truck, take it to another studio. It's awesome. So one gigantic Azo here, another Azo here, on an arm. We have a RAID. We could put two cameras, two computer systems in if we want to. Then I have a third monitor. It's on a roller, and that's what we put prints on because part of the favorites in the editing, we sit there and we print stuff out and we kind of watch how we're – it's another way of comparing variant but in a printed format. And that camera, that computer monitor is right next to me shooting because obviously I can't keep looking back over my shoulder at the digital tech station, and I don't want the tech to be right on top of me because we've had accidents in the past where I stepped on somebody and somebody stepped on me. That's a good one right here. There again, you can see how this setup works. Apparently Topher likes to watch. I like that. And
we typically work mirror. We usually have the displays mirrored. That way we all really are on the same page.
Yes. I want to see everything he sees. I know that some people like to see just the, you know, just the shots coming in, but I like to look at thumbnails at the same time because, as you can see, I'm going over each shot with the crew. We're talking about the files. I'll say, can I see this shot next to me? And if you can see what's on the monitor.
And it's great because Sarah can catch things that sometimes I miss and vice versa. We can see what's going on. She can call out commands to me. She can communicate because we're in the same place.
Yes. And I do believe that this also ties nicely into the idea of shooting tethered. And David, I do believe that was a question sort of, I'm sure it's floating around in a lot of people's minds. Like, me personally, and again, this is personal preference. Me personally, I really enjoy shooting tethered, especially when you're shooting movement, anything moving. It doesn't have to be dance. It could be hair or any sort of fashion shoot. To see what I'm doing as it comes in is really important, especially when there's clients. We want to make sure that not only does the hair look good, but the model's face reads. Is it shiny? Does the hair look gummy? All the sorts of things that happen once you move things a lot. You have to kind of refresh it. I shoot tethered. I have been using the IQ250, and we connected via USB 3, mm-hmm. and it is super fast. The refresh is amazing. I don't actually have the technical number specs if somebody wants to pop in and tell me how fast it shoots, but this has been a great camera because you get to shoot fast, and then I get to see it on
rendering
the screen.
Rendering speed is quick because of Capture One 8.
Yeah, but again, and it is personal preference. Me, I really, really enjoy and almost require that I get to have that feedback between me and my screen. But also, it's me and my talent. I mean, if you can see, every time I'm shooting, let's see if I can find a picture of her.
I mean, what it really does is it allows Sarah to have a discourse with her team and her talent about what you're building.
Exactly.
And refine it.
Exactly. And how many times do I say to the dancer, come over here. Let's sit and talk about the shots, like right here. And I say, this one works, this one doesn't. I really feel like if we could do five more like this. And she looks at it and she goes, okay, I get it. You know, models and dancers are visual people. They understand the image. When they see themselves on the screen, I think they're more likely to be able to refine their own movement, right? And right. Or I'm able to look on the screen and say, wow, that camera angle is terrible. Change it.
Absolutely.
Which is then why I end up on the floor.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, you walk away from the shot knowing that you got it and loving the shot instead of thinking, I hope I got it.
Yeah. I like to know.
You love to know.
So I see we have 15 minutes left. David, do you have another question?
Yes. I think you just answered that basically because it was the benefits of working with tethered. You also answered another question by showing on screen that do you use phase one cameras? And yes, you do, as we could tell. But you also use DSLRs as well, as far as I understand. But I guess central to that is Capture One. So as I said, I think you pretty much answered most of that. And
great. Well, then how about this? We have something that might take a couple seconds to explain, but I think it'd be really cool to talk about recipes. So now we're in the post part of our conversation, the export part, and I'm dying to show you all what we do.
All right. See this little cog wheel here? That is the export. That's the output tab, our panel in Capture One. Let's close out this. And that sounds good. Okay, so we use, it's very specific to our workflow, but it's very important because you can customize and build recipes from Capture One directly that allow you to do all sorts of things with exporting. And in Sarah's workflow, one of the great things is that we use Dropbox as an immediate way to sort of share images, be that with a client or be that internally.
Well, I mean, we have how many computers in the studio at one time?
Too many to count.
And Dropbox is sharing files to, and it's pushing files to every computer that we're working on especially, and by the way, David, I can hear you. You might want to mute yourself. It's pushing to everything, including the client. So the client can walk away with their final files already. That's pretty awesome. But how do we use Dropbox in our recipes?
Oh. Okay. So let us pull up. Let's just create a new recipe. We're going to call this our Dropbox, you know, client share recipe. So let's customize a recipe first of all. I've just added that. Again, just to recap, I went here. That's how you add a recipe, label it. Okay, so let's go to this one. Now you can customize it in this next little panel below, this process recipe. It really allows you to concoct whatever you want.
And at any given time, Topher, we might be exporting, I don't know, we could take the same file and export it 7 different ways, right?
Absolutely. And into these various formats. Look at this. We can do JPEG, TIFFs, PSDs, whatever you want. And yes, we can run multiple recipes at the same time. So in quick, we're going to make a JPEG. We're going to put it at 80% quality, just to save file size. We'll do it in sRGB color space, since that's a web color space, and people might be looking at this on the web. We're going to set this to 72 pixels an inch, since they don't really need to be huge. And now looking at all of this, I can look at this process summary below and get an idea of what my file size is going to be.
Right, and that's really important, because if you have a client who's on an iPad and you send them 10 megabyte JPEGs, it's going to take them forever to load, and they're going to be a little bit frustrated that they can't see them fast.
Exactly. So now that we've set this, we're comfortable with the recipe. We have to find an output for it. We have to find a destination for it. Where are these going to go? Okay, we want them on Dropbox, right? Okay, so the default for Capture One is to put it in the output folder, which is within the session. So we want to actually select a folder, however. So we're going to go to our client, our Dropbox, and we're going to select our client share. And we're going to just create a new temporary folder. Okay, that is where our files are going to go now. So we're also going to create a subfolder within that folder. So let's look at that, what happened just now. We set that folder. If I click on this little arrow, it's going to take us right into Finder, into that folder. So we're inside of the destination folder. If I want these to be within a subfolder, I could do like, these are low res, you know, final selects. How about that? Now let's go back to our green album. Ooh, we made all of our favorites earlier, right? We love these. We love this because now we have access to all of our top faves. I've just done a command A to select all. I'm going to go back to our tab. And now I'm going to process out all of these. I'm going to turn this guy back on right here so it selects all of these variants. And now I'm going to process these images.
And Topher, again, the biggest complaint that everybody always says to me is, I exported all of them and only one exported. Why? Because that little sneaky tab.
This little toggle.
Yeah, just make sure you don't forget to turn that one.
It's got to be on to select all the variants that are selected. Otherwise, it's just going to select the main one that's highlighted, which I know is a little confusing. But this is the one that's highlighted, but you see all selected. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. So now let's look in there. Ooh, we've got a subfolder that was created within this dialog box, and our images are now loading up into that space, into that folder. That
and subfolder. They're going in. Let's see that again.
Okay.
Let's go back into the Finder. I'll pull them up.
Okay. So back here,
yeah,
we're going there.
Exactly. And if you see this, you're like, oh, okay. You know that they're still exporting. They're syncing. Your Dropbox says I'm syncing. You also see that maybe you duplicated one. Oops, let's delete that.
Yep.
It's incredibly helpful. I'm telling you, it pushes to all your computers. That recipe saves. I mean, why would you want it only on your local computer if lots of people are using it?
Exactly. You can share it. You can print it. You can do all. There are a million uses for it, and it's a beautiful thing to be able to share directly to Dropbox.
And time saver is that then you don't have to send them to the client at the end of the shoot.
Yeah,
they already
it's
have
done.
Them.
Yeah. If you share the folder at the beginning of the day, it's done. They're getting them all day long.
Exactly.
You don't ever have to think about it again or return to it. Exactly. What you do there reflects on their end as you make changes throughout the day. So that is just one recipe. That's just one example. We have other recipes. Say, you know, end of day, we have to have all of the final, you know, images.
And full res.
Full res process. So it's like after each shot, like, I know what Sarah's favorites are. She's already made her edit, right, with the client. I'm processing these out to Dropbox, but at the same time, I'm like, okay, well, why not save myself some time by also turning on this wonderful other recipe to process out high-res TIFFs.
Right, and everybody wants the high-res TIFFs. And doing one export and doing all of it at one time is a huge time saver.
Huge time saver on the back end. I'm able to get out of here quickly, and we can save a lot of time.
Do you want to, and here's a really, actually, going along with the export, one of the things that's really important is that we have a hot album that I do believe is also, is that default all?
All images,
images.
Yes.
All images is a default. And then what we can do is take all the images that are in the favorites.
Again, it's a favorites thing.
Yes. Every single one of these, select all, and 348 pictures can all be exported at the same time. I don't have to go into each individual folder and export A, B, C,
right.
Pick them all up at once and do one master export. That's a huge time saver.
Huge time saver. Huge time saver. So definitely, and again, the trick is for each recipe, you really need to go through, though, and make sure you know where the files are going.
Yeah, because
otherwise it could turn into a huge
mess.
Oh,
my God. We've had times where we're exporting things. We have no idea where they've gone. Oh, God.
Like
too
this.
Many files. Like, yeah.
I have
what
no
is
idea.
R0?
I have no idea where that's going. So we're going to set this to our output folder, which just to show you where the output folder is, that's within the session. We have our session here that we're looking at, our session file, and then it's going to our exports folder.
Right.
So that's what's happening there. And you can, again, you can set for any recipe wherever you want it to go, whatever your destinations are.
David Grover, are there any questions while we...
Yes.
Our last couple minutes?
Yes, yes. There was a couple of questions on metadating / keywording, which I know is a huge... thing that you do with all your images.
Metadata is actually the last thing we're going to talk about. So ask me one more question before we go into metadata.
Okay. The other question, which a few people have come up, because obviously they've seen that you do quite a lot of work in Capture One in terms of tuning color and that and the final look of the image, which of course is important for the client to see. But how do you divide that between the tasks in Capture One and the tasks for retouching, for example?
Okay. So, well, this is actually a more interesting question than metadata. Metadata is definitely something I can show you how to do it, and then you do it. But I think the decision to make some changes in Photoshop and some changes in Capture One, knowing which changes to make, a lot of things that we do in Capture One, we'll do it to watch it on set, but my retoucher actually will export with some of the color settings turned off so that he can make those changes locally in Photoshop. Why do we do that? Really important. So let's go back and talk about this change in the shoe color, which is a very important question. There has many times, and let me find that shot that we made the change to. Where is that change shot?
Let's see.
The fringe dress. I lost my fringe shot. Did we lose mm-hmm. that folder? Go into Slacks. Okay. Well, let's talk about this really fast.
H.
Okay.
It's just filtered. That's why.
Got it. There comes a time, many times, where we'll make a localized adjustment, say, AKA the shoes, in Photoshop, in Capture One. And it's really important to see it on set. It's very important to everybody agree on it. But more times than not, we'll go into the post-production process and somebody will say, oh, no, I don't want them to be pink. I want them to be turquoise. Now, that's fine because we can always go back and make a change. But isn't it so much easier to make the change in Photoshop? Anything that would require anybody to go back and forth too many times, I don't want to go back into the RAWs and re-export because that's lost time for a retoucher. So things like that. Local color adjustments, we usually zero out when we start the retouching process. And if anybody was thinking the next logical step, what do you give your retoucher? The answer is I give my retoucher raws in the whole session, and the retoucher will go in and do his own exports.
The great thing is that we're able to use Capture One to inform the retouching, though, to inform the creative direction and create the creative
Absolutely.
Direction.
Well, and they're also, I've been saying this for years, the best part about shooting tethered, and the best part about shooting with these changes applied, color, contrast, sharpening, curves, levels, is that the client looks at the file and says, I approve, and then you basically have a sign-off on the look and feel of your final image, and nobody says, oh, it'll look better in post, or oh, it'll be this in post. No, you see right. it right then and there. They sign off on it. There's no surprises later. There's nothing worse than showing up with newly retouched files, and they said, but I didn't ask for that change.
Right.
You know?
what we export from Capture One becomes the reference for the retoucher to look at in
yes.
terms of color and everything.
Exactly.
They have to match what we're doing.
Exactly. And at the end of the day, every time that we've been asked to change the color of something or change, you know, any of these very local specific changes, I've changed background colors. Clients didn't like the shot until I changed the background color, and then all of a sudden the shoot went smoothly again. So I think that being able to make those changes gives your team on set a better idea of where it's going to go, and also an idea that it will get there eventually.
Absolutely.
Any more questions, Mr. David?
I think the metadata one, I would say, was one of the most popular one.
Okay.
Maybe this is
Let's
one for
that.
Actually, maybe one for Topher.
Yes.
Have you started using the new session template feature, if you've seen it? I can't remember if we spoke about that when we were in New York. Or maybe
yes,
you don't know about it yet.
No, I do know about it. I do know about it. I like the feature. It is really, I think it's incredible if you are duplicating your session with the exact same setup over and over again. So I think it's incredible for us because we can use it for testing. It's very easy for testing when we're not having a client-specific naming convention. And the great thing is you can...
What do you mean by testing, Topher?
Like when we are...
Test pops. Like when we've got an assistant standing on set with a color card?
Like if we are experimenting with something, doing
okay.
a pre-light.
Yes.
Something like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's very easy because it allows us to set up a session very quickly, throw the session in, and not really have to worry so much about the naming convention for the folders and the session. And it can include session albums, I believe. To get to metadata, are we ready to move on to metadata?
Let's do it.
Okay, great. So metadata is huge, especially for cataloging and sort of tracking and searching out images.
And another reason why I really love metadata, and this happens a lot, we shoot often. We shoot many people. I can remember almost everything, but I don't think I need to. And metadata allows me to go back into a picture and actually refresh my memory without having to search through a million different emails and communications. I know who the model is. I know what year we shot it in. I know the publication date. And these are things that I think every photographer always needs to know. Somebody says, who is the model? If you can't find that fast, you know, it shouldn't take that long.
It shouldn't take that
long.
So
this is how we came up, and this is our own personal way of really dealing with the questions that we always get asked. Who, what, where, when, why?
Exactly. And in this right now, you're looking at a template that we've sort of built, but we're going to clear this out for now just for this one, just to demonstrate, because you can really create whatever template, whatever keywords you want. The thing is, you go to this little information tab or panel, which houses the metadata in styles and presets. It's been recently separated from the clipboard. It was originally part of originally metadata got picked up on the clipboard along with many, many other settings. Now that it's on its own panel, the great thing is you can sort of write metadata without accidentally affecting color rated images or star rated images. So let's just say we want to give this a shoot title that lives in the metadata. We're going to call this, you know, phase one temp. We want to put the makeup artist. So we'll say, you know, Joe Smith. We want to put
models.
Model.
Model.
We're going to put Sarah Merge. There we go. You could literally put any type, you could populate this with any type of information that's really relevant to you or your shoot setup or your studio, however you're doing it. And the great thing is we can then save this information. Well, we can copy it to the clipboard. You can do that and paste it, or you can actually save the information here. So,
look at that.
So we're going to actually,
technically you can, but it's not being nice to us.
I don't know what's going on. So we're going to turn off all these guys and just, this is really, really key. So this is exactly what I was kind of talking about. So we don't really want to pick up in metadata the color or the rating, because this could really ruin our edit.
And it's
day.
Happened before, yeah. Where we copied and pasted and everything turned into a super fave and nobody knew which shot was the favorite.
So what we're looking at here is the keywords panel, and we just want to pick up keywords, okay?
Right.
So we want to make sure everything else is not affected by this style that we're about to save. And we're going to save this, and we're going to call it phase one temp mData. There we go. And now when we go to our all images.
There you go again with the all.
We can select all images. We have 359 of 359 selected. And now we can apply this wonderful phase one temp metadata. And boom, it's going to be on all of these images now. So let's go back to our not a good example. I think one of the issues is that we have some metadata already applied to these images, which is part of the issue.
Fighting it. Exactly.
But if we were to wipe them out quickly, we're just going to reset all of these, or at least that one. And 10 seconds, 30 seconds.
Okay.
Now, if we apply the phase one temp metadata, we will see, there you go. Because we had just reset these images.
Right.
We took all the everything that was off of them, all the settings off, and now we have just our new metadata applied. So metadata is really, really key in terms of cataloging and organizing, and you can add whatever information you'd like. It's completely customizable.
David Grover. Any more questions? Or I guess we have to kind of...
Yeah, we're almost running out of our time. Had lots of people saying thank you, thank you, thank you. So that was the fastest hour I've had of my life. Thank you very much.
No, I'm actually really surprised. I could talk about this all day long, and I want to talk about this all day long.
There's so many things.
And I feel like I can't even touch the tip of the iceberg. I mean, Topher and I were really excited and honored to be a part of this project because we really, I mean... Besides the fact that we really like what
we're
we do.
We're hardcore junkies.
We are hardcore technology junkies. And this really allows us to flex our muscles, right?
Definitely.
This software is great. But this has been fantastic. All your questions, I've actually been watching people talking, and I hope that we've been able to answer everybody's needs and concerns, but also that get you a little bit excited about delving deeper into the software if you don't know certain things. I hope you all try it.
Yeah, I think, you know, definitely everyone's been inspired that there's so much powerful things you can do in terms of, you know, I've watched your shoots and the amount of work that you get through in a day, which is incredible. And you can only do that because you're efficient, because you and Topher work well together and you have the various different ways of filtering and sorting and color tagging. Without that, you'd just be drowning in, as you say, thousands of images without
thousands. You know, and I think that
any way
is
of getting
actually,
to the
as
good
I
stuff.
Sit here and look at Topher, it's honestly it's about the software, but it's also about teamwork. We have a shared communication and we have a shared understanding of how it works, and
definitely.
We both work together, and I think that
yeah, we speak this language together. It's our own little language. We love it.
So I hope you guys can tell that we have fun doing this too.
We have a blast.
Definitely. And if the people listening there haven't watched the video of you and Topher working together and The format of the video is great because Topher and Sarah are sat together and discussing how they work together. It's really interesting. So everyone will get a follow-up email in a few days' time. So I'll put a link to that video in there as well in case you haven't watched it, and other ways how to follow Sarah and Topher in their work and everything, because that's really enlightening as well, and great to great to be a part of that. So. Sarah is awesome, George says, which is good. He said he attended one of your workshops, Timeless Energy and Image Quality. There we go. And Ted says the quick tab made the whole thing worth it, and everything else was icing on the cake. So I think that's definitely good way to describe it.
I thank everybody, because this is special. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks. Right. I'm going to grab the presentership back off you, hopefully, just so I can say goodbye to everybody, basically, and thank Sarah for her time, essentially. We put them back up on screen so we can be reminded what they look like. So there they are. Whoops, says he. There they are. So it was really a privilege having them working with us today. And yes, we will get them back for more, as many people have asking. But yes, look out for your follow-up email in probably 1 to 2 days' time. It's sent out automatically. And we'll put a bunch of links in there how you can keep up with these two guys and learn from them once again. So many thanks for your time, Sarah, Topher, and everyone else. And we look forward to seeing you again on future webinars and other activities. Take care.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye. Cheers. Bye. Bye.